As you guys can visually see, we got the grandfather of possibilities, Mr. Ron Klein. We're going to bring him on here in a few minutes. But before we do that, Hartz, I think you've got another video that you can play. And then when we come back, I will kind of share a little bit about Ron, our relationship. And then for the next half an hour, I will tell you guys this. Take a mental break. I'm not saying don't watch this video, but I think your brain might explode like we just did with Facebook, because Ron is the smartest man I've ever met. And just through the interview, I didn't know what the heck to do. Our team literally had to listen to the playback. I don't even know how many times, probably more combined than each individual person, just because of his wealth of knowledge. And so, you know, this guy has done amazing things. He's literally changed the face of the world, as the inventor of the century, recently awarded. And so, Ron, before we jump you on for the interview, Horace, go ahead and rock that that video.
Yep, we're rocking it. 1 second, guys. I think we might have crashed Blue Jeans too.
Did we really?
There we go.
I was actually a teacher. I taught 7th and 8th grade pre-algebra. Now I'm in a solid foundation to build from. Make sense? You build your house on rock. Then you can start to create wealth and assets.
One thing for listeners to take away with them today by listening to this, they should write down what we're doing.
That where you are right now is not where you want to be. Yes, you're going to be listening to this. And I think you need a coach, a mentor, or a GPS system.
What direction can I help you go in this weekend? Greg becomes my friend. We start playing tennis, and we got to write a national best-selling book with, how many of you are familiar with Les Brown? Yes, gotta be hungry, right? How many of you know Brian Tracy? Eat That Frog. Boom. Yes. So I got to write a national best-selling book as a teacher from Maryland with three of the most prominent people in the personal development world.
Hey, this is Blaine Etheridge, and I am so honored and blessed to have spoken at the National Christian Writers Conference 5 times now. And I'll tell you this, as a speaker, I get more out of this than most of the attendees, probably because I'm surrounded by so many amazing people that are giving back.
Get it.
You've got to figure out who you are and surround yourself with somebody that will help you remember that and motivate you rather than put you down. How are we feeling this morning?
Awesome, guys. So again, that's laneetheridge@gmail. It is in the comments to get in touch with Lane or Horace Reese@gmail to get in touch with me. If we can do anything for you guys, serve your communities, please get in touch. But transitioning from us to the legendary Ron Klein. Guys, I'm so excited for this interview. Ron has been a friend of mine and helped me get through some really difficult times. I've learned more in 2 minutes with Ron than hours with anybody else. That is how smart this guy is. Incredible, incredible person. Along with his wife, Arlene, they are just two phenomenal people. So excited they are in the book. Ron, seriously, you are one of the most amazing people I personally know. You're literally, a kid at your age. You have more energy than me sometimes, and I love being around you. Thank you for jumping on with us. We really appreciate you.
You guys are absolutely awesome. I mean, incredible. You feel so humble, in which I am, and I just, first of all, I am so intimidated because there's two good-looking guys in here. I mean, handsome. But, you know, it's such a pleasure. I was really looking forward to this. I've been interviewed a lot of times, just like we all have been. But this is such an opportunity because, first of all, you're really smart. What's that noise out there? Wait, I got to turn the noise off. Okay. My office got noisy all of a sudden. This is such a great opportunity because it's exciting. I'm so excited for both of you, really. You've done a tremendous job, and you've got incredible capability. Just what you're doing with this. I mean, this Facebook Live, you've got it down to a perfection. I love it. So I'm ready for any questions you ask, and I don't want to consume too much of your time. So go ahead.
Well, we want you to consume a lot of our time, so you're stuck with us.
I love it.
Ron, I think, I'm gonna allow you to start somewhere. But more importantly, I think, you know, very often it can be overwhelming and intimidating. You speak all around the world, and you've been blessed to be interviewed at every single thing under the sun. And I think very frequently for newer entrepreneurs that are watching this, and that will be reading the book, I think very often we get overwhelmed and we say, man, I want to aspire to be like this person, but they forget who they are and they forget to really focus on, you know, what they're gifted at. And they say, you know, I want to be inventor of the century, but they're not necessarily programmed that particular way. Or they say, I want to be a best-selling author. You know, they don't necessarily have the ability like Horace, no offense, who's a two-time number one best-selling author, you know, with the best grammar in the world. And so I want you to just kind of hit on before we start with the progression of, and I believe me, we focus on our weaknesses and our strengths. And I think the more we talk a lot about self-awareness and the more we know who we are, the more we can do that. And one of your skills as a consultant is taking somebody's problem and creating the solution. That's why you get paid to do what you do. And that's why you've invented some of the most transformational things in the world. So just start off with maybe the key formula that you taught us in the book about what to look for and how to do that, if you remember specifically what I'm referring to.
Well, I don't remember specifically because I'm old. However, I've got a philosophy. And my philosophy, you know, you don't have to be the sharpest knife in the drawer. You could be a plain guy. I mean, I came from a very simple, plain family. My dad was a mailman. My mom was worked in a department store. And I was a kid that grew up in Philadelphia, and I didn't have anything special. But what I learn and what I teach is you've got to be, and here it comes, I'm going to turn these magical words into explanations. You've got to be smart, daring, and different. Please, everybody remember that. And when I say smart, I don't mean a graduate with a PhD from Harvard. I mean live in the present. Thanks, Elaine. I can't see that, though. So when
smart,
I say,
daring, and different.
Yeah, when I say smart, I mean be aware. Pay attention. Learn something new every day. I'm constantly learning something, even at this old age, because everybody carries different knowledge and different education around with them. And when you learn and you're aware, it's wonderful. I mean, that knowledge is power. And again, you don't have to be the sharpest knife in the drawer. The second thing, when I say daring, don't be afraid to make mistakes. And I preach that constantly. If you're not making mistakes, you're not educating yourself because you're just being a lump. And if you make a mistake and you paint it the wrong color, paint it a different color. Just don't make the same mistake twice. But be smart, be daring, and most important, last, is be different. And when I say be different, don't try and just offer ideas or sell ideas. You must provide benefits. So whatever you're doing, whatever you have to offer, it's got to be a benefit. So again, be smart, daring, and different. And I think that's what I practice. And when I look at something, if somebody comes to me with a challenge, I look at that challenge and I say, let me see if I can paraphrase it. Can I paraphrase it in one word or one sentence? Is it a communication problem? Is it a personality problem? What is that problem? And once I identify that challenge, then I simplify it tremendously and find out what's the solution. So there is no problem. in my life. I say problems are frustration, and every problem is converted into a challenge. And there's that gift and there's that opportunity behind every challenge. And all of the things that I've ever come up with, it wasn't that I was an inventor and I sat in a think tank holding my head, what can I invent today? It's where do I see a need and what can I do to fix it? And even with the credit card, I won't go into the whole thing of how I invented that, but that problem came to me as it was a very slow process back in the 60s. It wasn't automated. They didn't have the magnetic strip. And the credit card companies had to provide big long list every month to the merchants. Very time considering a time problem that they had to go through. So once you identify the problem is how do you speed it up and how do you take away that long delay at holiday time where people have to go through the slow process? And that's the challenge that I had, and that was the problem I solved. How to speed it up, identify the problem and how to simplify it. So that's my input so far. Any other questions?
Awesome. Yeah, give us the background of the smiling cobra.
Okay. I teach everyone how to be a smiling cobra. And the way I say that is I refuse to have a battle of wits with an unarmed person. Okay? That's my definition of a smiling cobra. Know who you're dealing with, and if this person takes advantage of you and steps on your toes, then all of a sudden show them your fangs. I never point an unloaded gun. I don't make threats. And what I mean by that, I don't walk around and carry a gun. But when I say I never point an unloaded gun, if I'm going to do something or if I say something, I follow through and I do it. So if you're going to make Well, for instance, a lot of people will come to me and they'll say, I have a collection problem. How do you collect? I mean, I've got a problem. I've gone to these people over and over again and they just don't respond and they're not paying their bills. And I said, all you have to do, the very simple way, is tell them that if they don't satisfy that invoice now, you're going to have to seek counsel. And what does that mean? Right away, they say, oh, you're going to take it to a lawyer. No, you're just going to seek counsel. I'm going to talk to somebody who's a little bit smarter than me and can give me some good advice. That's what I mean by being a smiling cobra. Don't have a battle of wits with an unarmed person. Does that answer my question?
It does. Thank you.
Okay.
And we want to talk about, at least at some point, some of the actual inventions that you've done and the new one that you just launched, I believe, out in New York. So we'll get to that here in a second. But I think more
Which
importantly,
is amazing.
Ron, yeah, I mean, it's just everything you've done is phenomenal, and it literally has changed the face of the entire world. But, to me, as much as the accomplishments are amazing, the person behind it is really the key in the relationship that we've built together with you and Arlene. And I sit here and I talk with Sophie some nights, and I said, how in the world does Ron continue to do what he does? Why does he still do what he does when he doesn't necessarily need to? And I think there's a big difference between need and want. I think you've got this desire, whether it's because you've accomplished so much and it's just your, progression as an entrepreneur, but why do you continue to go out there and do everything that you do, traveling around the world, speaking, when you don't really necessarily need to? You're at a point in your life where you can sit back and enjoy life. What drives you at this particular point?
Lane, we're here for a purpose. And I've been told by our maker many, many times. I was in the Korean War. I was injured. I was fortunate enough to be helped with a MASH unit. And they brought me back, so I survived. And I was 19 and a half when I was shot. And I felt, okay, somebody's telling me a story. I'm here for a purpose. We want to take advantage of the time that we're here because it's such a short period of time, even if we live to 100. 100 years is a short period of time when you look at how long this earth has been here. So we've got to serve a purpose. We're here to contribute and to give. And you've heard that many times from all of the mentors. When you give, you get. So with that, I came back and after I was discharged from the service, I had a many, many series of serious accidents where I almost perished, and I survived. again, that just fortified, I'm here for a reason. And with those serious accidents, and I had some serious problems. I even had 4 years ago a heart attack that I didn't even know I was having a heart attack until it felt like an elephant on my chest. And the heart attack was so bad that I ended up flatlining. And after I flatlined, I saw this great experience of, I thought I was a black feather floating in the air, and I'm seeing these white flashing geysers off in the horizon. And then I hear the nurses hollering from the hospital bed, "We lost them, we lost them." And I said, "No, this is wonderful. You didn't lose me. I'll be right back." And then, of course, they brought me back. And that really told me the story that I'm here for a reason, and I've got to continue to contribute. Because, to quote Les Brown, I'm not empty yet. Age is just a number. And for those people that think they want to retire and just sit around and do nothing, and they're waiting for that magic moment, they're foolish, because we're here to contribute. And I love to solve problems, and by simplifying them, and to get people to understand, if you just look at this in a very simplistic way and reduce it to its basic elements, it's a piece of cake to solve. And I did that with the credit card. That was a delay problem where it took too long to issue credit. And I just happened to recognize, because I pay attention every day, tape recorders could be a possibility. I was technical, and if I didn't have a technical training and technical background, I could have sought that kind of capability from someone else. But I was able to do it myself. And what I did was recognize that there were tape recorders that could be reduced into a little magnetic strip on the back of a credit card, make you the motor, record the account number, and everybody's heard that story. That was the invention of the magnetic strip and the credit card. It was basically a simple task. And the task was, how do you speed up the process and take the liability away from the merchant? Then with MLS, well, that was pretty simple too. You've got people who want to go from point A to point B. When they get to point B, the realtor wants to know, what is it that you need, so they can do their homework ahead of time. That's how the MLS came about. And with banking, we had touchtone phones, and we had data systems in the banking institution. Well, I don't want to run to the bank to get my results of what my account is. I want to be able to input some means, and they want to talk back to me and tell me what I have. Simple solution. Use the touchtone phone, take it to a system. That system, again, recognized that account number that it keyed in with the touchtone phone, and it came back with synthesized voice telling you the results of what's in their database. That was the banking voice response system. Then when I finally got to the New York Stock Exchange, that's a longer story, and that was wonderful, because that was just opportunity after opportunity, and how I got there was interesting too. Strictly by paying attention, after I sold my first public company that grew quite large, and I was at retirement age of 34, I figured, okay, I'll sell the company, retire at 34. I fished for 3 weeks. That was wonderful. Got pretty bored and went back to business and started another company. That lasted quite a while into my 60s, and there was great stories along the way. When I finally got to the New York Stock Exchange, through all of the opportunities of paying attention and taking advantage of things that I recognized, there was my opportunity, because that was still quite antiquated. It hadn't been automated. And I looked around and I said, I could simplify some of these processes, automate them, and take advantage. And that's what I did after I did many of the program trading things. I automated the corporate listed bond market, where that became an automated market just like stocks. And that was in 1983, and made a lot of money doing that, because I charged the bond brokers a fee for joining my operation, and then paid them. Then they had to pay me a rental fee for the equipment that I provided for them. But again, it all came from opportunity, from paying attention, not being afraid to make a mistake. If it was the wrong color, what do? You paint it a new color. And you sell benefits, not ideas. Okay? I'm watching the clock. Awesome. I don't run out of time, so I'm speaking fast.
You're good. Well, we've got enough time. And I think something that you just said is very important for every entrepreneur, which is successful entrepreneurs like you see an opportunity in every problem. Most people see a problem in every opportunity. And you know, they're sitting there complaining about, oh, well, this doesn't work, or this doesn't work, or this doesn't work, or this is too hard, or, you know, Facebook Live is new to me, or whatever it is. And they just sit there and complain all day long. And that's how their life ends up being, a big complaint. And so you've been an expert, and it's interesting because you paid attention, and that's gotten you paid, right? And it's just very interesting to see that when you solve a problem, people will reward you for that. So why don't we do this, Ron? I think obviously Changing Lanes International focuses on really helping people when life shifts or when things change, making sure that they can continue at least driving forward at some level. And a lot of the industry that you helped develop with the credit card magnetic strip has changed a little bit. And you don't necessarily have to launch into that specifically unless you want to talk about the new chip and your opinion about it. But more importantly, you know, what do you recommend to somebody when things change, when life changes, either by the choices they've made that have created the results, undesired or desired, or life happens, whether it's the heart attack, whether it's a divorce, whether it's whatever it might be. How do you encourage somebody with your consulting clients to really stay focused on what they need despite the changes that'll happen?
You know, sometimes I simplify it so I make it look like every opportunity, every change, every condition is a room. I look at it as a room. That's the venture, that's the operation, that's the function I'm going to get involved in, whether it be marriage, business, or whatever. It's a room with a front door. I open that front door and I don't close it. I look around before I step into that room very carefully. I look for a window, I look for a back door, I look for a way out. And then I say, you know what? What's the worst thing that can happen? Failure is not an option. I might have to change it, make a change or paint it a different color, but I feel safe enough to close the front door behind me and step into the room, because I can worst case everything, no matter what it is, and go out the back door and start over again. So I worst case every situation. And if you think about that, the most serious thing that can happen to a human being is they die. Well, that's not so terrible. I just told you about when I flatlined, it was a beautiful experience. So the worst thing that can happen is you die, and then it's all over, and it's not so worse anymore. It's not terrible. The other thing is you cannot succeed in a venture that you go after, whether it be personal, whether it be a marriage, whether it be an enterprise or a job. And what's the worst thing that happens? There's only plan A, not plan B. You change. You paint it a different color. So there's nothing so terrible. You know, people seem to think that the worst thing that can happen in their life is they can't make money. That's the easiest thing to do. It all depends on what level of risk you want to take. There's plenty of jobs out there. Even though there's people that say there's no work, if you're physically okay, and even if you're handicapped, there's plenty of jobs out there. It's just you've got to pay your dues and move forward. And worst case, every situation. And that's my philosophy on that.
Okay, cool. And I think something that you just said is so amazing. If dying is the worst thing, I actually agree, but I disagree, because most people never truly live. And I would say that that's worse.
Mm-hmm. Agree.
And by not taking that risk and walking around, Les Brown, as you mentioned earlier, also said, you know, the biggest wealth in the world is 6 feet underground, because people were too afraid to actually do anything with their thoughts, their ideas, their business mind, and everything. And so for those of you who guys are watching this, you know, if you were to look at a timeline of Ron's success over 80 years, it's pretty unparalleled to anybody else out there in the world. But it's really the years that he's lived of those 80 that he's been on earth that are what we should be looking at. And the same is true with all of us. And age is just a biological thing. It's how are we utilizing the time that we have. And especially in today's society, with the unknown of everything that's happening in the world, if you're not living the way that you want, I think it's time for a lane change and go out there and really live in the lane with the vehicle that you want to do. And it's just so important, Ron. And so, you know, for everybody listening, I don't think people can really fathom the fact that you're literally in their back pocket every single day. And you've created something that every single person probably on the face of the earth that has the means to do. We're not, you know, taking into consideration the people that live in unfortunate situations that don't have a credit card or a debit card, but you've impacted so many lives. And what does that mean to you? Do you even think about it? Do you even take time to really fathom what you've done? Or is it just kind of, hey, you know, I'm on to the next thing, which is what I want to talk about next, your newest invention?
It, you know, we both have the same philosophy. You change lanes when necessary. I'm saying I love to change lanes with you. And while we're doing that, I'm taking another can of paint with me in case it needs a different color. So our philosophies are the same. I think anything that you get involved with in life, it has to provide a benefit, not just for you, but for others. If it doesn't provide a benefit, it's a hobby. And that's fine if you can afford to do hobbies. And I think you want to work at something where when you realize and think about it truly, you can't really separate work from play. Because of the 24 hours, you know, we need a third of that to sleep, if most of us sleep that long. And then the other time is work and play. And they should be one of the same. You just have to manage that time carefully. As far as the accomplishments that I've made along the way, if somebody says, Ron, what are you? I'm a problem solver, and I turn those problems into challenges. And I don't think about how many people it's going to benefit. All I know is it has to benefit someone. And if it benefits someone, I never thought when I invented the credit card magnetic strip, it was going to affect billions. I knew it was going to help Macy's department store and Eastern Dry Goods, I think up in Canada was one that I worked with, or Eaton's in Canada. So I never thought how many people is it going to help, but how many people can it help now? And it helps some. And if it goes viral, that's wonderful. I mean, that's very gratifying and satisfying. I don't think about it every day. I don't walk around with my thumbs under my shoulders, throwing my chest out. It's just, I'm no different than anyone else. It's just, I solved the problem that they didn't. And when I speak to people, when I'm up on stage, I want to engage those people so that plug yourself in, make believe that you were there with me. You would have done the exact same thing when I showed them how simpler it could be and the best approach to take. And that's what you've got to do. Simplify it, find the benefit, implement it. There's only plan A. If it doesn't work, paint it a different color and go back to plan A again and try it this way. And that's the approach. And that's the same way that, you know, I feel we were talking a little bit about my age. I'm now 81, going on 82. But the thing is, I'm not empty. I'm here for a purpose. And if I would just sit around and stop, I'd just be that little old man that was a has-been who did that then, but he's not contributing now. If I'm still breathing the air that we're all sharing, I better produce. And that goes for all of us. If you're sharing our air, produce. You've got to do something with your life. Just don't be alone. So I realized that I'm not empty yet. God left me here for a purpose, and that's when I decided to come up with this last invention for the visually impaired to help them. It's an app on the phone that's free and little adhesive labels that you paste on any item that the visually impaired person wants to identify. They point the phone at it, and it tells them what it is. And it's a minimal investment. You get 100 labels for $20. Tell me what visually impaired person wouldn't make a $20 investment to be able to walk into their closet and know their blue shirt from the red shirt, or know their one prescription from another prescription. So, and it has unlimited applications. And here's an interesting thing. I developed it and designed it for the visually impaired. I've got it well rounded for that market. But it has so many other applications that I say, you know who the inventor is going to be? You guys. Everybody. Mm. They're the innovators. They're going to look at this and say, oh, my God, you realize what this can be? This is a programmable label. It can do this, this, and this. So I'm going to create new innovators in the world that can take this invention and run with it and expand on it. And that's my way of giving to them. If I can help one blind person in this world, which I'm already helping many, it's worth it to me. There's 260 million blind that I looked at. I figured there's 21 million visually impaired people right here in the U.S. If I can just help a handful of those, I'd be happy. So that's a little bit about my new invention. Not empty yet.
Not empty, and you gotta stay full until you are. You know, same thing with a car, right? I mean, you've got to literally drive until it's empty, and then all you do is you just refill it back up. And sometimes we need motivation. Sometimes we need inspiration, encouragement. You know, you bring up a good point, because as a consultant and what you do with your clients, you know, a lot of people aren't visually impaired. They're mentally impaired, or they're emotionally impaired. And, you know, I think it was Helen Keller who basically said, you know, basically, I can see better than most people because I have vision, and most people don't have that. And so, you know, it's
people, there's many, many people that hear, but they don't listen. That's a big difference.
Absolutely. And if you rearrange the words, the letters in listen, you can spell silence, right? And so sometimes it's just as important to remain silent and learn from people that are there. And so with what you do, and sometimes with what we do, you know, in a car analogy, is we do have blind spots, which is why you need to check over your shoulder before you change lanes in order to see what you can't see, what the car isn't allowing you to see. Mentorship is the same thing. Consultants are the same thing. Books are the same thing. And sometimes something like a book, the reason we did this thing in the first place, I didn't necessarily want to do all the work behind it. What I know is it's somebody's story in here. Somebody that's downloading this book today is going to read a chapter in it that they needed to hear, that is going to help them see their own blind spots that they weren't seeing before. And that's why I get passionate about doing what I do and speaking and everything, because it's not our job to fix people. It's our job to allow them to maybe get a tune-up in their own life and kind of fix the things that they need. And that's what you're an expert at. And so we appreciate your wisdom and knowledge and everything you're doing. And you inspire us every single day. Every time I see you, you know, like Frank Shankowitz says, wheels up. Every time you're flying to a new place to speak, you know, it's amazing. And Horace and I will be down in the Tampa Clearwater area again. So I'll get to come see you guys. I think we're going to do that the 29th of December, towards the end of the month, to hang out with Kevin Harrington, who will be on in a couple hours. So we'll make sure that we coordinate with you and hopefully get to meet up with you and Arlene as well.
Absolutely. I would like to mention, if anybody's interested in that new device for the visually impaired, they can just go on the website and take a look at it. And it's a downloadable free on Apple and on the Google Play Store. And it's called EnvisionEli.com. That's E-N-V-I-S-I-O-N, Eli, E-L-I.com. And the reason we named it Eli was a biblical character who read the Bible in Braille. So that's interesting. And on that site, you can either download it on your Apple phone, or you can download it on your Android phone. And it is free. The app is free. And then when you go on the website, there's a little test pattern. It looks like a QR code test pattern that's reprogrammable a million times. You can just keep reprogramming it. And that, so you can actually play with it and try the whole concept. And there's even an area on the website that, if you're innovative and you've got some more ideas for it other than just for the visually impaired, I would love to help you with the idea and help you carry it forward. So that's how I feel that I'm making a contribution. And and for anybody that wants to go on my website to hear all about some of the other things, it's the number 4, ronklein.com. That's ronklein.com.
Yep.
And I can't tell you how much I appreciate you, both of you, for doing this.
What I'll do for you guys, Ron, I'll post the link to your site for ronklein.com in the comments. So you guys can just click on the comment, go to Ron's site, check it out. Also, there's a book that Ron Klein wrote as well. I can go grab it, but it's called Grandfather of Possibilities. It's still on Amazon. I'll post that as well. Highly recommend you guys read that. Honestly, from the bottom of my heart, Ron has one of the most amazing stories. I honestly recommend that book, along with Life in the Fast Lane, available today.
Yes.
definitely check out Ron's book. I'll post both the links for you guys in the comments below. So check that out. And thank you guys, everyone, for the shares. Ron, we're getting some amazing comments from you. Chris Sullivan said the best advice he heard from you is to sell benefits and not ideas. So that really is resonating with our audience. Thank you again for jumping on.
Well, thank you,
sir. Chris. Go ahead, Ron. Sorry.
I welcome the privilege of being on. And I'm sorry I took so much time. I'm seeing the clock here, but sometimes I get a little.
You didn't take enough.
I get a little worried.
We could have listened all day. No, you were exactly at the allotted time. We're We're at 1 p.m. Eastern time, which is where you are, Ron. And so that's exactly what we wanted. So we appreciate you. I'll be in touch with you and Arlene once we set the actual schedule for the Sarasota area, Tampa. And we'll come see you soon. And thank you again personally. I don't know if you were involved or not, Arlene. I'm sure it was you, right? The guy always gets the credit. Sent us a very, very beautiful gift for our engagement. So thank you for that. And I would look in your mail here soon for something from us as well.
Well, you know, we're newlyweds, so I'm just still learning from her because we're only married 57 years. So I'm starting to learn. And I tell everybody it works so well, we're going to start living together now. But
exactly. About every 57 minutes, I get in trouble. So I'm learning a lot.
Thank you again so much, and lots of luck for our wonderful book. It's a gem.
Thank you, Ron. I appreciate it.
See you soon. Bye-bye.
Take care.